another episode of Fat City Spinout on tap for you today. Records either new to the collection or that have seen a listen recently. Thanks for joining me in the music room today. Been kind of a gray, gloomy June around here so far. Hopefully things start improving soon. I'm representing Stranger Things today. Got done watching the brand new season 4, not too long ago. Getting a lot of attention for its use of 80s music, the period where it's set, the era I grew up in, and specifically, of course, Kate Bush's Running Up That Hill, featured prominently in the plot as a key plot device, not just background music, but mentioned by name. All the attention has seen it gone up to number one, apparently, in the charts again. Kind of cool to see that happen. I think I had that tape to cassette off the radio at the time before getting that vinyl copy. In other news, I got into watching Bollywood movies somehow. I'd never really checked out any Indian cinema before. A lot of different genres there, action movies, dramas, what have you. Much more prominent use of music than it seems than in Western movies. Seems like even the action movies pause every now and then for kind of a song and dance number. It's kind of crazy, but some cool acting, cool stories, great cinematography and special effects in some of these. I'm gonna show you a clip right now of one I enjoyed recently. I think it's fairly new, maybe from this year, called Gangubai Kathiawadi, hopefully I'm saying that right, stars the beautiful, luminous Alia Bhatt as a young girl who was sold into prostitution, ended up becoming the boss of the brothel she works at, becoming something of a crime boss of her area, tough, jaded, cynical, and eventually going on to advocate for prostitutes' rights in India, something of a true story, I believe. In the scene I'll show you here, she's just met a young tailor and is letting her guard down, conducting a bit of a wordless flirtation, seductive, through a card game with him from her veranda while he's down on the street below, outside a record shop, actually. And she begins to open herself up to romance. Wonderful scene from a movie I enjoyed. Check it out. जब सैया आए शाम को तो लग गए चांद मेरे नाम को जब Early 2022 saw a brand new album release by legendary reggae singer Horace Andy, who broke through to much wider acclaim through his work with trip-hop group Massive Attack in the 1990s. As he continues his collaborations with them over the years, he took time out to work with equally legendary UK producer, dub mixer Adrian Sherwood, who also did a highly acclaimed album with Lee Perry, Rainford, and its dub counterpart, Heavy Rain, were the final fully completed works to surface from Lee Perry. Let's hope such is not the case with Horace Andy. Incredibly, this is their first collaboration, Midnight Rocker, taking its name from Safe From Harm, a new version of which, the song he originally did with Massive Attack. This is a red vinyl edition from On You Sound, brand new 2022 release, revamping several of his classics. This Must Be Hell, lead off track, I believe originally done with producer Tapazuki. Materialist, I believe originally done for 90 The Observer, Rock to Sleep, Mr. Bassey, all classics from his catalog, but some new songs as well. Today Is Right Here, containing the wisdom of a man now in his 70s, looking back on some of the advice his mother gave him, the things she wasn't right about, somewhat rueful looking back at some of those of his generation who fell by the wayside. Horace Andy, they call him Horace Andy, the brother cool as candy. For the Real Gone Music reissue label for a while now across a number of recent videos. Something about their nice quality pressings at an affordable price point and the eclectic range of styles and genres they put out. Something about all those factors appeals. I'm starting to pick up titles they put out on spec if they sound good. It's a genre I want to pursue further. I did pick up a reggae one that they put out back in 2019 recently. This is the first ever vinyl reissue since its original 1968 release on Trojan Records. It is the second album by Robert Dandy Livingston Thompson. Dandy Returns, originally released 1968 in the UK. This is a Real Gone Music reissue on Orange Marble Vinyl, first ever vinyl reissue. Dandy Livingston was a Jamaican who relocated to the UK in the late 1950s at the age of 15, began getting involved in music through the 1960s, cut some 45s in the ska and rock steady styles. One of his big early hits was A Message to You, Rudy, later covered by the Specials. He also became a record seller for an Indian Jamaican by the name of Lee Gopthall, who shared a building with Chris Blackwell of Island Records, who had an office for Island Records on the top floor. When those two collaborated to form a new venture called Trojan Records to release Jamaican music in the UK, Dandy Livingston got in at the ground floor. As well as releasing Jamaican music, they had a sideline of putting out local productions. And Dandy Livingston, as a by now in-demand singer and producer, was tapped to handle some of that workload. He had his own imprint label called Downtown Records. His productions of the Brother Dan All-Stars was some of the very first releases ever to appear on Trojan Records. And his second album appeared on the label in 1968, mainly romantic-themed early reggae here. This was the era of boss or skinhead reggae, as reggae was crossing over to the white working class youths in the UK known as skinheads, who gravitated to the choppy beat of Jamaican music at this point in time. When Trojan Records ran into financial difficulties in its early years, it was two hits produced by Dandy that kept them financially afloat. They were his own Reggae in Your Jeggae and Tony Tribe's version of Neil Diamond's Red Red Wine, which would later go on to be a hit all over again for UB40. Dandy Livingston, one of the early stars of Trojan Records, based out of the UK.
All through the night, all through the night.
recent arrival from an order at Vinyl Me Please during one of their flash sales was an album by a group I'd heard a little taste of on a Blackfire Records sampler put out by Strut Records. Hadn't really planned on getting their full album. I'd seen the reissue around, but when Vinyl Me Please had it on for a good price, I ended up grabbing it. It is the 1977 debut by Washington DC's Experience Unlimited. Originally came out on Blackfire Records. This is a Now Again Records reissue here on a Vinyl Me Please Essentials Bronze Vinyl Edition. Comes with the art print and extensive liner notes on the history of the band, the history of Blackfire Records, the label. The group had actually started out in the Washington, D.C. area as a group called the Young Hustlers. They were a black rock group, heavily inspired by Jimi Hendrix, of course, referenced in their group name, Experience Unlimited, but also by Carlos Santana and many others. By the time of this debut album, their horn section, they had a full horn section in the group, had already been drafted in to work on some Blackfire Records sessions leading to the group coming to record this album, and they had started to move in more of a funk direction. So a couple of instrumentals on here, but plenty of blazing rock guitar work. George Clinton, Parliament Funkadelic, maybe in the mix as well. Social consciousness, political awareness on display in the lyrics, the final instrumental funky consciousness, maybe serving as a statement of purpose or intent of the group. They had, as I said, full horn section, lots of horns, those fiery guitar riffs, sometimes recalling Carlos Santana, and very politically aware lyrics, as on Peace Gone Away, It's All Imagination, the subject of peace and prospects for the young generation in mind. People, more of a dreamy, ruminative, more reflective song, but plenty of funk, plenty of rock in the mix here. The group would go on to a long career through the 80s and 90s, moving more into the Washington, D.C. regional go-go scene. Listens from the collection now and from the glorious girl group era of the early 1960s with the Angels. They had started out as a New Jersey-based all-female group called the Starlets, revolving around sisters Phyllis and Barbara Allbutt. They had scored some minor local hits, did some studio backup vocal work, but had suffered some rejections from producers, had a couple of lead singers who left to go solo, and the sisters by this point had virtually given up on music to pursue their education. Phyllis was training to become a teacher, and Barbara had been accepted into the prestigious Juilliard School on the basis of her talent for arranging music. However, with new lead singer Linda Jansen, they did a demo of a Percy Faith hit called Till, which impressed producer Jerry Granahan, who had previously rejected them. The song became a sizable hit and saw the girls renamed as the Angels, with an LP called And the Angels Sing appearing on Granahan's Caprice label in 1962. Including further hits by the girls. This is a copy I found in Seattle some years ago, $5 or so, I think. Reasonably good shape considering the genre and the age of the record. Just some notes from a previous owner on the back cover there. Following the departure of lead singer Linda Jansen again, the girls would move to Smash Records, a subsidiary of Mercury, and add new lead singer Peggy Santilia. Working with the songwriting team of Feldman, Goldstein, and Goterer. They would score their biggest hit with 1962's My Boyfriend's Back, leading to an album of the same name. This finds the girls' angelic pinpoint harmonies tempered with a sassier side as the title song kicks off the album with the familiar hand claps and the spoken intro as the girls give a kiss off to a jilted suitor who they find unworthy and promise retribution to for the lies he's been spreading. The song hit number one on the Billboard charts. The LP containing a mix of the girls' sweeter side, the Angels, with their sassier, more tough girl personas. So Angels and Devils and the same album, and the album finding somewhat of a theme running through it of similar send-offs to jilted would-be suitors, with final track, The Guy with the Black Eye, virtually a note-for-note copy of My Boyfriend's Back, but showing the inevitable comeuppance of this fellow who's been found unworthy of dating the girls. Glorious sounds with the girls' pinpoint chiming harmonies. There are covers on here as well of The Chiffons' He's So Fine and Bobby V's A Night Has a Thousand Eyes that are virtually the equal of the originals. Classic from the girl group era. Another find from Seattle at the same time as the other. Also very good shape on Smash Records. Mono copy.
And you hung around and bothered me every night. When I wouldn't go out with you, you said things that weren't very nice.
Today, guys. Hope you enjoyed. Thanks to everyone who's been following along with my Lee Perry series. Should have another episode of that coming up for you soon as we get into the magical year of 1976 when Lee Perry's Black Ark truly hits its stride and enters into its golden age. Stay tuned for that, and thanks for watching, everybody. Cheers.